the Parking, Traffic, and Safety Committee meeting for July 9th. And I guess I have to read this per New Hampshire RSA 91-A-2. The chair has declared the COVID-19 outbreak an emergency and has waived the requirement that a quorum be physically present at the meeting pursuant to the governor's executive order 2020-04, section 8, as extended by executive order 2020-5 and emergency order number 12, section 3. Members will be participating remotely and will identify their location and any person present with them at that location. All votes will be by roll call. So I'll start it off. I'm Peter Whale, and I'm at home in my house at 100 Gate Street, and I'm alone, except for my dog, Angus.
Peter Rice, Director of Public Works here at the DPW staff. In the building. I'm alone in my room, though.
Juliet Walker, Planning Director, and I'm in my office by myself.
Todd Germain, Fire Chief. I'm in the office by myself.
Mark Newport, Police Department. I'm in my office at work by myself.
I'm Harold Whitehouse. I'm at the Public Works building. I'm in the boardroom, and I'd like to call the attention to the old Pierce Island Bridge going to the pool, 1940-1950 era. Very rickety.
Yeah.
Steve Pesci, I'm at my house by myself.
Who's that? Mary Lou McElwain, 259 South Street, at home by myself.
Oh, I'm Jonathan Sandberg. I'm at my home, 160 Bartlett Street. I'm by myself.
Erica Wyganek. I'm at 319 Lincoln. I'm by myself. It's possible my kids return and maybe make an appearance. They're unpredictable like that.
Jane Farini, I'm here at my office on the fourth floor, Assistant City Attorney, just participating in the meeting today, not a member of the Parking and Traffic Safety Committee.
Okay, thanks, Jane. So I think we have everybody here, so I don't think we need to do a roll call. So I call the meeting to order. We have a financial report. I don't know, Ben, if you want to talk about that at all, or...
Sure. Clearly, you see that. Let's get there. All right. So we're at 77% of budget when 91% of the year has gone by. Obviously, we'd like it to be higher than that, but you have to recall that this post totals through May when we were just starting to ramp back up. The good news is the budget that was revised for FY21. I put the meter fees, the meter space rental, and the transient revenues all at 30% of last year's totals, and we're in the 60s and 70s. So we're doing better than I budgeted going forward. Obviously, this what you see in front of you is an awesome news, but there's 1 month left, and June was stronger than we budgeted for bit of 2020, or FY20, I should say. So this 7.2, I think, was what our number was when we first did a revised budget, and it's going to be somewhere in the 7.4, 7.5 range. So the shortfall would be $400,000 less than we had anticipated, which is good news. I mean, less losses is better. But so I can certainly answer questions about what you're seeing here, but I think the numbers kind of speak for themselves.
Okay, any questions for Ben at all from anyone?
Yes, I'd like to ask one question, if I may, Mr. Chairman.
Yep, go ahead, Errol.
In reference to parking violation, what do you account for the increase? Well, up to 102%. What's the reason?
Well, we didn't, we really haven't stopped writing violations. Even during the COVID shutdown, we still wrote the violations for the hourly limits so that we could keep traffic moving, even though we weren't collecting funds. So what you're seeing here is there will be a little bit of a lag. We wrote fewer tickets during that 5-week time frame, so you'll see a little bit of a lag. Plus, you know, we have our vendor consistently sending out first, second, and third violation letters and certified letters for those that get 10 or more tickets in a year. A lot of those have gone out, so you're probably just seeing the results of that. It's good news for sure.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, go ahead.
Hands up. A question. Ben, due to the street closures, closing off parking spaces for restaurants, do you predict what the revenue loss is going to be over, say, until the 1st of November? Is there any prediction?
Well, it's difficult to say, Mary Lou. If you have plenty of inventory, then the loss is actually zero because cars weren't coming anyhow. What we're starting to see is some of your secondary areas becoming a little bit more crowded. Worth Lot is showing regularly 70% peak now, where it was in the 30s. Bridge Lot even is in the 70s, where it was in the 30s. And what that means is you're seeing traffic getting pushed out to a little bit further away. So right. Some of that is because space is unavailable, and some of that is because space is becoming more desired. So we're seeing upward trends in all of our numbers, obviously. I had a very conservative budget going into next year, so I feel confident we'll be able to meet those figures and possibly do better with stay and pay.
And I would think that the Foundry Garage numbers would go up because people won't be parking there instead of on the streets. Is that happening?
They're stronger versus last year than Hanover's are, to be honest. Versus last year over year sales.
Okay. Well, good. Considering what we're in the midst of.
Yes, ma'am.
Good. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions for Ben?
Chairman, I move the financial report be accepted as presented.
Second.
So we had a second. So we need a roll call vote.
Okay. Chairman, I'm here with Harold. This is Amy.
Okay. Hi, Amy.
Hello. I'll do roll call votes then. Public Works Director Peter Rice.
Yes.
Planning Director Juliet Walker.
Yes.
Fire Chief Todd Germain.
Yes.
Police Captain Martin Newport.
Yes.
Mary Lou McElwain.
Yes.
Pete Pesci.
Sorry, yes.
Thank you. Jonathan Sandberg.
Yes.
Harold Whitehouse.
Yes.
And Chairman Wayne.
Yes.
Unanimous.
Okay, so we have no public comment. I'm assuming there's no one in the waiting room that I can see. Let me just look again. I don't see anyone. So our next, we'll move on to new business. So under new business A, proposed stay and pay graduated parking meter rates ordinance changes by DPW. I'm not sure, Eric, if you want to talk about that. Mayor Ben?
Yes, I can walk us through this. At our last meeting, the PTS committee approved the concept in the meter rates or the parking rates for the stay and pay change. So what that means now is we need to go into the ordinances and change all the existing ordinances to reflect the fact that there won't be any time limits now with the stay and pay. The 3-hour limits, the 2-hour limits, 1-hour limits, 4-hour limits. So it needs to be all rewritten and revised in Chapter 7, our ordinances. And these sections here provided in your packet showing are all the wording that needs to be changed in the ordinances. And so before this goes to the City Council for their three readings, we wanted to make sure that the Traffic Safety Committee was okay with the proposed changes to the ordinances. And we could go through this line by line if you like, or I can summarize. Some of these are pretty self-explanatory.
Yeah, I would just summarize it, Eric. You know, I think the key points, I think the extended hours, you know, at each of the areas, I think that's where people are probably going to have some questions.
Yes.
It's also true that there's some cleanup in here of some very old language. So that may or may not have anything to do with stay and pay, but Eric can speak to that as well.
Mm-hmm. Why don't we just do the meter rates and the stay and pay first, and then we can go to the cleanup on the streets, I think.
Okay.
If that makes sense to everybody.
Yeah, and we can, I think it's how the order is. If it isn't, we can skip ahead to that part. This first section is just defining, you know, redefining high occupancy zone and cleaning up that street. Bow Street and Daniel Street were listed twice, so it's combining it into one line item. Standard occupancy zone, everything that's not high occupancy is now called standard occupancy zone, including the parking, surface parking lots. And then we get into the rate here at section C for the non-resident parking rates for the downtown occupancy zone. $2 for an hour for hours 1 and 2, and $5 each hour for hours 3 to 11. And these are in effect from 9 a.m. to 8 p.m. Monday through Saturday, and Sunday from 12 p.m. to 8 p.m. Holidays are excluded. Then we get into resident parking rates.
Eric, can I speak to that really quickly?
Sure.
So I believe part of today's discussion is exactly hours 1, 2, and 3 would be the $2 each hour, because a suggestion was made to leave the first 3 hours the same as they are currently. And this stay and pay program simply provides an option to stay longer if you want to, but the first 3 hours remain the same. So I think that this packet it looks to undergo some minor revisions to that third hour before it hits council, so that there isn't any confusion as to what we're proposing. So it says hours 1 and 2, and that was what you were originally presented with and approved. But since then, we've discussed it and thought that 1, 2, and 3 should each be the $2 each hour, and then hours 4 through 11 would be then raised to the 5 each hour. And subsequently, in the second zone and B zone, hours 1, 2, and 3 would be $1.50 an hour before the price increased, in the same manner as before, just an hour, just one more extra hour at that first rate. So the person who would normally have stayed 3 hours will have no change in what parking costs them to do so. But if they decide they want to move forward and stay longer, that's where the price increase takes effect. So there isn't any natural effect other than you're allowed to stay where you weren't before. So that change will be made before it hits council. I just wanted to point that out so people didn't think that we were leaving something the same that we had agreed to change. It's just, this was already published by the time we had that discussion. Yes, ma'am.
I just wanted to comment that I was going to ask about that because I saw that hour 3 was indicating a different price range. So for residents, we will go from $1.50 for the first 3 hours and hop up to $2.50, right? We won't have that $2 in between.
Just a second. I have it here. I just need to shorten my screen a little bit. I have an updated version of this right here and I can share my screen if you like, and maybe that's the thing to do. Should I do that? You can take
it. Yeah, why don't you do that?
Okay, I have that opportunity or no?
You should.
Okay, hang on a second. Share screen. Stay and pay for council. That should be the one. Okay, so let me just pull this up and do this slideshow. Current slide. That'll make it a little bit larger. So you see, originally, this is the turn hour. I'm kind of pointing at it with my mouse. This is on the far left, this is current rates. And then there's public rates and resident rates to the right, proposed. So the current rate right here turns at the third hour, ends at the third hour. You have to leave. And in this case, the first 3 hours will remain that same rate. So the $6 here is the same as the $6 here. And if somebody decides to move forward, then the price changes. To answer your question, looking over here on the resident rates on the very far right, you're looking at $1.50 for the first 3 hours, same as now, then a softer turn and a second softer turn at the fifth hour. It kind of splits that turn up a little bit, makes it a little bit softer for the residents.
Oh, so it go. Wait a minute. I'm just
pitching. On the far right.
So, yeah, on the far right, resident rates, zone A. You're talking about zone.
Yes, correct. So that's a dollar. Currently, it's $1.50 an hour, and it stays $1.50 an hour for the first three. Right. And then your turn hour jumps 50 cents instead of a whole $3 like a public rate churns.
Yeah.
And then the fifth hour is a second turn hour of another 50 cents, and then it stays flat the rest of the day. That's just to soften it and not have it be such a hard turn for the residents at that fourth hour. Same as below that on the B and C zone.
I think that's confusing. I would go with one rate for hours 1 through 3 and a second rate for hours 4 through 11. That would just be my choice. I think it's unnecessary to do it. Either drop it back to $2 for hours 4 through 11, or just jump it up $1 per hour. That's just my...
Got a motion? Are you making a motion there, Lou?
Do I need to make a motion? Yes, I would make a motion that we eliminate that $2 fee for residents and make it $1.50 an hour for hours 1 through 3 and $2.50 an hour for hours 4 through 11, as long as it we're doing something equal to the non-resident, 50 cents an hour less than the non-residents, correct?
I believe I understand what you're saying. I'll second that for further discussion.
Sure.
Okay. I just think that going from $1.50 to $2 to $2.50, oh, I should raise my hand, sorry.
Go ahead, I can't see you, Mary Lou, so.
Oh, I'm on there, I thought.
Okay, no, I.
Okay, I just don't think it's necessary to do these three levels. I would go $1.50 up to $2.50 for residents, and for non-residents, $1.50 up to $3.
So I just for clarification, the proposed public rate for non-residents, Ben, is in the high occupancy is $2, and for residents it's $1.50.
Correct.
Yeah.
In the low in the standard, it's $1.50 for the non-residents, and it's $1 for residents.
Correct.
So what Mary Lou, my understanding is you're saying that instead of having a two-step change for residents, have a one-step change going right to the 250. So you go from 150 to 250 for the high occupancy, and from $1 to $2 in the standard.
That's what I understand.
That's right. That's what I would propose. That would be my motion. Thank you, Peter.
I can make that change. If it gets seconded and all that
stuff. Yeah, I'll second it. I'm not supposed to, but Mary Lou, I agree with you. It's going to be confusing. So it should be $2.50 for that fourth hour.
No problem.
Mr. Chairman.
Harold, there are a number of people with their hands raised.
Yeah, I can't see everybody. So,
okay, I'll speak up. Jonathan was first, and then Steve, right. And then I believe Mr. Whitehouse.
All right, go ahead, Jonathan.
I was just curious, I assume it's prorated, maybe like it's by the quarter hour, maybe, is it? I mean, if you stay for, four hours and 15 minutes, is it, how much will that cost?
That works in the garage, as that does not work with prepay. You have to tell the device how many hours you'd like.
Oh, all right. So you have to pay, and it has to be an hour increment.
You pay in blocks, yes.
All right. So if you stay for 4 hours and 1 minute, you're paying six. Well, right now it's $6.50.
No, you would either have to pay for that extra hour and stay, or you risk getting a site. You know,
right.
You'd be over your time. In a garage, when you know when the person enters, you have a time frame that you can do that. You don't know when the person enters and leaves the lot because it's an open lot. That's why that's done that way.
Okay.
And with the app, you have a choice to add more time to your stay. You'll get an email when you got 5 to 10 minutes left.
Okay, but you can only add an hour. You can't add 15 minutes.
Yeah.
That's correct.
Okay, and then how do people, how clear are the rates advertised? Like there's going to be a sign, or like how will people know this?
Well, the app will show you exactly what the rates are, and you basically have a scroll wheel on the app, and you just scroll up to the number of hours you want. It tells you what the cost is. The stand-up blue devices with the touch screen on the screen will have a graduated rate explaining how it works. Mm-hmm. And certainly when you choose the hours before you hit OK, it'll give you your total and tell you what you're buying.
Yeah.
And then the small single space devices that they just own the space in front, then that will be, it'll be on the little digital screen there.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I just think it's just going to be very important to communicate in order for like market prices to be effective. People have to know and be able to compare, you know, that's all. I mean, because the idea is to get people to move, is why it's more expensive to stay longer, but they have to know that in order for that to work.
Well, right now we just force them to leave.
Right.
So in this case, they'll have the opportunity.
Right, right. But they have to know that. That's all.
I think Jonathan, you know, has a point, and sure. We can look at how we post it. You know, we can look at effect. You know, if there's effective signage, we'll take a look at that.
Mr. Chairman.
So Steve was next, and then Mr. Whitehouse, and then Mary Lou just raised her hand as well.
Yep.
I just want to support the motion. I know it's been seconded, but I think Mary Lou, it's a good idea. I think when we're moved to this kind of a system, simple is better for pricing. And I have to say, I've always felt that the Portsmouth meters and app were very easy to understand. So this change helps keep it even simpler and cleaner and easier. This is kind of an experiment to see if we get adequate turnover by giving people choice to pay more and stay longer. So I think simple is good, and I support the motion.
Mr. Chairman.
I think Mary Lou is next, Harold.
Yeah, I think Harold is.
Okay, go ahead, Harold.
Okay, just one informational question. Is the City Council up for the third and final reading on this document?
That's a good question.
No, sir, it'll be the first.
First reading.
It'll be the first reading, okay. All right, thank you. You know, the staff has put a lot of work into this, and I like to just have them comment once more how they feel about this tremendous change. Can we hear from one of the members of the staff or two people from the staff other than the chairman of the park and other than the public works director?
Go ahead, Ben and Eric.
Well, honestly, I think that, you know, we get a ton or most of our revenue from tourism. I think it's counterproductive to invite people to a beautiful seacoast town and then slap them on the wrist if they don't leave fast enough. I think that, you know, given that we've moved this so the first 3 hours are the same as the current 3-hour price and with an opportunity to stay longer, I think that the average consumer such as myself will be relatively unaffected except on those occasions that it's worth it to me to stay and use the space. It will be interesting to see what the economic impact is in terms of when people decide that turning is what they want to do. I'm going to look at that $5 rate and say, okay, I can get my food eaten inside of 3 hours. But a Bostonian who's on vacation would prefer to not have to move their vehicle 500 feet every couple of hours. I think it's a positive. I think it's a win-win all the way around.
And I'd just like to add that once we put this into place, it would be great to see how it works. And we want to make sure we still have empty spaces on the street. You know, that 85% occupancy level is what we're really shooting for. And if it looks like there are people that are taking advantage of it and we're still well over 100% occupancy, that would be an indication that perhaps we need to look at the rate structure and revise it to get our desired effect out there. This is the desired turns. We don't want to be overloaded on on-street parking still.
I agreed. I'll add to that two things. I see Steve's raised his hand. The first of which being we're already seeing triple digit occupancy in some of our high end areas right now, and that's great news. But it does return an old problem, and which is going to be exacerbated by the loss of space to the restaurants outdoor seating. We've got the inventory to cover it right now, but it, you know, this will be a higher cost inventory that will be gone. But so Eric is exactly right. We're always shooting for the 85%, and this will give us an opportunity with the, you know, 6 month, a year's worth of data. The public will tell us, the market will tell us whether or not we're still priced too low. If we're in the 150-200% range, then the market's telling us this past 4 or 5 years our pricing has been too low.
Okay, Steve and Stephen and Mary Lou.
I was just going to add that I know the staff is very good at this, but please be prepared to collect the data right off so that in 6 months and then 12 months we can look at this and make an educated decision. I agree completely with everything you just said, Ben. And I think, you know, what generates complaints from the public is when there isn't that 15% available spacing. So
you bet.
We want to pursue the higher revenue, which I think the opportunity is there, but it's a balance. And I look forward to seeing the data after 6 months and 12 months.
It will be interesting. I'm updated every 5 minutes, so we should know the next morning what we start to see.
That's funny.
Go ahead, Mary Lou.
I had 2 points. I'm wondering if there is less traffic downtown because people are looking at the spaces that are for outdoor dining and they don't want to come into the downtown city. And secondly, are we really promoting both the Hanover and the Foundry Garage? I don't think that sign is back down on Market Street Extension that says what the price of Foundry Garage is. So I would think we would try to get traffic out of the Market Square area with the number of restaurants that are out in the street or out on their sidewalks. And I'm just wondering if you have any idea if the traffic has decreased since we put barriers out for restaurants, or do you see it the same?
You know, I don't know if Eric's got cameras out for that. He's better at that than I am, because I can only go off paid revenue. If nobody pays, I show zero, you know, entry. Right. So right. Eric may or may not have data on downtown traffic looks over time frames. I can tell you that since we're seeing the more people over in the bridge lot, you know, which was in the 30s early on, now it's regularly in the 70s. What's that telling me is that the public is finding that space.
Yeah. Well, that's good. I think we should encourage people to park elsewhere in the garage.
Yeah.
Get out of downtown. Let it be safe.
Safer. Which is why the pricing at Foundry hasn't changed.
Yeah, that's good. Okay. Thanks.
I don't have any data downtown, but out at Nobles Island, we have a permanent counter, and that's showing traffic's about 80 to 85% of normal right now.
That's great. So I think we have a motion on the floor to make the changes that Mary Lou her recommendation, and that would the fourth hour be 250, I believe. That was the motion, right, Mary Lou?
Right. That's right. For residents, yeah.
For residents, correct.
Yeah.
So if we want to take a roll call vote on that, Amy?
Yes. Okay. Public Works Director Peter Rice?
Yes.
Planning Director Juliet Walker?
Yes.
Fire Chief Todd Germain?
Abstain.
Okay. Police Captain Mark Newport?
Yes.
Mary Lou McElwain?
Yes.
Steve Pesci?
Yes.
Jonathan Sandberg?
Yes.
Harold Whitehouse?
Yes.
And Chairman Whalen?
Yes.
8-0 with 1
abstention.
Okay, so I guess we should just continue on with the other changes.
Looks like Jane's got her hand up.
Go ahead, Jane.
Hi, everyone. I think the original motion was to eliminate the distinction for the third hours for both the standard and the high occupancy for residency. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And also, just to clarify, because I'll be helping with the revisions, that the non-residents, there is the first 3 hours remain the same, and then hours 4 to 11 have the increase. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Jane, I'll send you a schedule.
You want to keep on going with this?
Yeah, let's just keep going.
Okay. So the rates, we just covered that. This is where we're getting rid of the 500 foot rule. So when your meter expires, you won't have to move another 500 feet. You'll just have to either put more time in it or get a citation.
Good.
And this is where we're getting into the time hour limits. And we have some changes or some questions for the committee here, is because this is where we have found some outdated ordinances that really need to be updated and to reflect what's out in the field today. The 1 hour limits, we're proposing to get rid of all of those. We don't have any 1 hour spaces in the city, so it makes sense to just eliminate this section entirely. 30 minutes is the next section. We're not making any changes to that. The 15 minute section, spaces remain the same as they currently are in the ordinances. Now, there are some that are getting changed that this committee has made over the past year, and that is part of the omnibus ordinance, which the council will also be taking up. So what's shown here is just actually what is still the current ordinance, even though it may not reflect the changes that have been made from this committee over the past year, such as these right here. That's in my comments on the side here. If the omnibus is adopted, these sections will be revised.
Any comments from anybody on these? I know further down on the 2 hours, I have some comments.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead, Mary Lou.
I have a question on 7.326, the 30 minutes. Wondering what the advantage of that is with the purpose. It would seem to me that it takes more effort on the meter readers to go and check for 30 minutes. Why are we doing 30 minutes?
These are spaces outside the downtown, actually. They're down on Islington Street where it's metered. And it's just to keep the spaces turning over for the businesses in that area. They've requested that those 30-minute spaces be not be eliminated.
So I'm wondering if 30 minutes is adequate, if it should hop up to an hour or hop back. The 30 minutes, just that's the only place we have 30-minute parking, right? It's right there in Islington Street.
But these businesses are primarily the Cafe Kaleem and to-go kind of places.
Yeah.
And they've been content with the 30 minutes. And so I guess that we keep that.
Okay. If they're asking for it, that's fine. I just wondered if it was arbitrary, which never happens. Nothing is ever arbitrary.
Right. So any other questions on the 30 minutes? Okay, continue on, Eric. Okay.
All right. These are the 15 minutes that got changed by the committee earlier. Now, here we go to the 2 hour section. The ones that are in red have been struck out are up in Panaway Manor. Those are from when there used to be an entrance into Pease through Panaway Manor, and we would have some parking problems. But now with the Grafton Drive, this problem doesn't exist anymore. So we're deleting these 2 hour restrictions in that neighborhood. These other ones here are Hancock Street. We found this ordinance that was still in the books. It said 2 hour parking all the way from Marcy Street to Pleasant Street. Yet in the field, it's only marked for the first three spaces next to Marcy Street. So in order to be consistent with what's in the field, we would need to have a recommendation to change this ordinance to just spell out those three spaces closest to Marcy, and the rest of the street would be unlimited or up to 72 hour parking as any other free on-street space would be.
Now, I got a lot of phone calls on this. So essentially, the business at the corner of Marcy and Hancock, they use those three spots. And I think some other Strawberry Bank businesses use that. But the rest of Hancock is really a 72-hour parking that runs all along Strawberry Bank all the way up to the corner of Pleasant. And the second part under B, there is no parking on the southerly side from Washington Street to Pleasant Street on Hancock. Mm-hmm. So, you know, my recommendation is just to clean this up and leave those three spots, you know, the way they are. And because people from the downtown do park on that Hancock Street.
Yeah.
area, you know, they have condos or whatever, and actually all the downtown workers use it too. So it fills up and turns over.
So do we want to make a motion on each one of these as we go, or should we compile a list and make a...
Whatever the committee wants to do. Do you want to do them all together, or do you want to break them out?
Probably, it might be easiest to break them out, I think.
Okay. Take a lot of time. So I'll make a motion that, as Eric says here, that we eliminate the southerly side from Washington to Pleasant Street on Hancock, and then go with the, I think it's the three space for the 2-hour limit.
Mm-hmm. Second.
So we had a second for Juliet. Any discussion? Okay, we need a roll call vote.
Harold's muted, I think.
Sorry. Public Works Director Peter Rice?
Yes.
Planning Director Juliet Walker?
Yes.
Fire Chief Todd Germain?
Yes.
Police Captain Mark Newport?
Yes.
Mary Lou McElwain?
Yes.
Yes.
Jonathan Sandberg?
Yes.
Bob Whitehouse?
Yes.
And Chairman Whalen?
Yes.
Unanimous.
All right, so Eric, you want to continue on? So we have Islington Street next, yep. I guess.
Yes, no changes to Islington Street. Those 2-hour limits would stay as they are. On Madison Avenue, there is, or Madison Street, there are no signs out there right now, even though it says in the ordinance here that it's a 2-hour limit. So
my question is, so are people using that for overnight 72-hour parking currently?
Yes. And there haven't been any requests to put the 2-hour signs back.
Okay. Any discussion on this?
From
Madison Avenue or Madison Street?
Madison, it says Avenue here, but.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, it's actually Madison Street. It just the ordinance says Avenue.
More cleanup. Need a motion for that one. So I don't have information on when signs came down or why in the past, but my team does not enforce a 2-hour limit if it's not signed that way, because it's not fair to do so. That's why Hancock is treated the way it is, and only those three spaces that are signed are enforced that way. So effectively, Hancock's already 72. If they're not asking for 2-hour on this one, I just say leave the signs down and change the ordinance, but that's just me.
Right.
Can I make a motion?
Go ahead.
Okay, I'll make a motion as recommended by staff.
Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Okay. Any more discussion? Let's do a roll call vote.
Works Director Peter Rice?
Yes.
Hunting Director Juliet Walker?
Yes.
Fire Chief Todd Germain?
Yes.
Police Captain Mark Newport?
Yes.
Mary Lou McElwain?
Yes.
Steve Pesci?
Yes.
Jonathan Sandberg?
Yes.
Harold Whitehouse?
Yes.
And Chairman Whalen?
Yes.
Unanimous.
So the next one, Eric, do you want to talk about that? It's Mechanic Street.
Yes, Mechanic Street. This is the northerly side from Marcy Street to the Pierce Island approach. These spaces are not out there right now because they were removed in order to allow construction vehicles to get out to the island for the sewer treatment plant project. So, you know, if we leave it, then the spaces will be there as a 2-hour limit after the project is done. Or if we take them out, then it will be unlimited parking when the project is done. There's another question altogether: is would we rather see no parking there at all? I mean, when there is parking out there, it makes Mechanic Street very narrow and difficult for trucks and vehicles with boat trailers to get through there one at a time.
Right.
So it's
I'd make the motion to eliminate those parking spaces.
I second.
Okay. Any discussion? Okay, roll call vote.
Okay. Public Works Director Peter Rice?
Yes.
Planning Director Juliet Walker?
Yes.
Fire Chief Todd Germain?
Yes.
Police Captain Mark Newport?
Yes.
Mary Lou McElwain?
Yes.
Steve Pesci?
Yes.
Jonathan Sandberg?
Yes.
Harold Whitehouse?
Yes.
And Chairman Whalen?
Yes.
Unanimous.
All right.
The next one is Middle Street, northerly side from Lawson Street to Summer Street. There are no signs out there. This is a unlimited or 72-hour parking on this side of Middle Street. There hasn't been any requests to put tower signs back up. So our recommendation would be to remove this item from the ordinance. So there is no longer a two-hour limit on the books.
I'll make that motion. This is seems unnecessary.
Is there a second?
A second.
Okay, any discussion? Okay, seeing none, let's do a roll call vote.
Public Works Director Peter Rice?
Yes.
Planning Director Juliet Walker?
Yes.
Fire Chief Todd Germain?
Yes.
Police Captain Mark Newport?
Yes.
Mary Lou McElwain?
Yes.
Steve Pesci?
Yes.
Jonathan Sandberg?
Yes.
Harold Whitehouse?
Yes.
And Chairman Whalen?
Yes.
Unanimous.
Okay. Let's see.
So Summer Street, I guess?
Summer Street, yes. This shows that both sides have a two-hour limit from Islington to State, Monday through Friday, 8 to 5. However, there aren't any signs out there relating to that ordinance. There is a two-hour limit for B. Those signs are in the field by the church, but the other one, this A item, is not in the field, and we haven't had any requests to put two-hour limit signs back up there. So my recommendation would be to eliminate A under Summer Street.
Okay, is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? All right, roll call vote.
Public Works Director Peter Rice?
Yes.
Planning Director Juliet Walker?
Yes.
Fire Chief Todd Germain?
Yes.
Police Captain Mark Newport?
Yes.
Mary Lou McElwain?
Yes.
Yes.
Jonathan Sandberg?
Yes.
Harold Whitehouse?
Yes.
And Chairman Whalen?
Yes.
Unanimous.
Okay. Go ahead. Jane, you had something?
Yes, I just wanted to remind the committee to also do a vote to adopt the red line changes, taking the spaces out of Panaway Manor, and that way that's incorporated in your decision today.
Okay, who wants to make a motion?
Can I just ask for clarification, Mr. Chair? I thought we were looking at the amendments first. Are we going to vote on the whole ordinance at one time? That was my understanding.
Yeah, that's kind of, we're just looking at, let's look at all the amendments and just make sure that we're not missing anything. You know, I don't want to put up any two-hour signs somewhere where all the residents are using the street for parking. So anyway, so sure. What else do we have, Eric? What other changes or red flags do we have?
Let's see. The three-hour section gets removed entirely. And the only four-hour section that remains is on Livermore Street, where it's free parking next to the park.
Yeah, and I believe those signs have been up a while.
Yeah.
Any issue there?
But why would that be 4 hours? Right? It's kind of strange to keep the 4 hour for one street and it's for park access. Why not just make it one of the other categories, whether it's... I'm just curious.
That's a good question, Steve. It was before my time. I think it had something to do with the Wentworth home that's down the street, parking there, if I remember correctly. And some of their guests maybe were able to park on Livermore Street. That's the only thing I can think of why. But it's been kind of an outlier. It's the only place in the city where you could park.
I'm just curious. I mean, we're in this streamlining mode. I didn't know there's an opportunity, but if it's a sleeping dog, then leave it.
Right. I mean, the other option would be leave it 72 hours, and I don't think you kind of want to do that. You want to have some turnover there, mm-hmm. You know, so people can enjoy the park. So. Yep. But it, that was before my time, so I'm not sure how that 4 hours ever developed. Okay, anything else, Eric, that we need to look at?
That was it for the ordinance changes.
Okay, so Julia, do you just want to make a motion that we adopt?
Sure. So I make a motion we adopt all the remaining red line changes as proposed by staff, and with the obviously including previous amendments that we already voted on.
Okay.
I'll second that.
And any discussion?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Hello, White House. May I? Mr. Chairman, may I speak?
Sure, go ahead.
I've read this document two or three times, and I never saw any reference to veterans with veterans plates. I don't know if the city realizes it's a state RSA ordinance that adopted probably 10 or 15 years ago, that all veterans with veterans plates can park free at any of these meters. It's a city that has a limited of 3 hours, they can park 3 hours. Limited of 2 hours is 2 hours. So in some place it should be documented and put in this report, because I heard the city council the other day talking back and forth, and they didn't seem to realize that there was free parking for veterans. And you've got to prove to the state motor vehicle department that you are a veteran. You have to submit a WW-14 form, which tells you about your time in the service and what actions you saw. So I was surprised to see that this nothing is mentioned in this report at all.
Yeah, Ben, do you want to? I think we talked about this, Ben, a little bit.
Sure. Unless there's been a very recent change, Harold, my understanding of the ordinance is that unless it's a handicap or ADA, with a placard or on the veteran plate has the handicap signal, that veterans are actually in our state subject to paying like everybody else. However, in Portsmouth for some time, we have made a practice of not charging veterans, but just asking them to observe the posted time limits. So the suggestion has gone around that we codify that rather than try to capture a revenue stream we already don't have and the PR that would go with it. I think that we should codify that and say, you know, that's what we're doing. We're going to allow for the 3 hours for veterans to stay and without having to pay. It's treat them the same as an American with Disabilities Act vehicle.
Ben, are you suggesting that it should be documented in this report?
Jane?
Mr. Chairman, may I?
Yeah, go ahead, Jane.
Thank you. We have quite a lot of housekeeping to do on Chapter 7, and we're going to clear up the veterans, and there's also a handicapped walking disability section, and try to fix that up as well as some of the penalty sections. So that's on our rotating list, and we're certainly going to be addressing that. But at least for this purpose, I think the stay and pay and the payment, we're trying to move that forward in the first instance, and then we'll come back with those other housekeeping issues which we need to address.
It's a long-term effort. It's a cobbled together law or ordinance that needs a complete overhaul, and Jane and Eric are both working very hard on that. That is part of the discussion, Harold.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Okay. So I think we have a, go ahead, Mary Lou.
I just wanted to comment that this is an enormous amount of work that Eric and Ben have done, other members of their departments, and it's very impressive to see that they went through this practically street by street, meter by meter. So hope that the residents appreciate all of this work and that it's a benefit to the residents and brings in some tourist dollars.
I need to acknowledge Farini's efforts as well. She's,
yes, Attorney Farini has been huge.
Yes.
Care of the editing.
Thank you.
Okay, so we have a motion on the floor, I believe, to adopt this, right, Juliet? So a roll call vote.
Okay, Public Works Director Peter Rice.
Yes.
Planning Director Juliet Walker.
Yes.
Fire Chief Todd Germain.
Yes.
Police Captain Mark Newport.
Yes.
Mary Lou McElwain.
Yes.
Steve Pesci.
Yes.
Jonathan Sandberg.
Yes.
Harold Whitehouse.
Yes.
And Chairman Whalen.
Yes.
Unanimous.
Okay, so continuing on under new items, we've got a request for an all-way stop at the intersection of Thornton Street and Sparhawk Street by residents of the area.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, there's a picture here on the screen. Can everyone see that?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. And you have put a traffic camera out there. I've gotten some data, preliminary data, and it shows, you know, fairly equal volumes on both streets. And there is limited sight lines when you're coming out of Sparhawk here due to this house on the corner and some trees on this corner. So I think it probably would be a good idea for a four-way stop. Every other intersection along Thornton Street is already a four-way stop. So I don't know if you could, I can get back to you with some more definitive measurements on sight lines, but right now the preliminary data is showing that this would be a worthwhile case for a four-way stop. So it's whatever the pleasure of the committee would be, you can have me report back or you could take action on it at this time if you feel.
Mr. Chairman.
Go ahead, Harold.
Yeah. I feel waiting another month might be not necessary. I should think we'd leave it up to the staff to decide and us to decide right now, because that's, you know, a four-way stop there is what we requested. So to wait a whole month and come back to it for another meeting in August, I don't think it's necessary. That's how I feel.
Any other discussion?
Just for clarification, Eric, you feel you've done a warrant analysis on this and you feel that it's warrant, it meets those requirements?
Yes, two similar streets, similar volumes, and there is a sightline issue coming out of the side street. So I think in this case, it would be justified to put a four-way stop at this location.
Okay, my point being, we need to be cautious about, we receive a lot of requests for four-way stops, and there is an analysis that needs to be done, and we try to make sure that when we put the four-way stops in, it does meet those warrant conditions. So mm-hmm. I'm just trying to make sure it's clear to everybody that four-way stops are not a speed control thing, which many people believe they want to use them for speed control. They're really just their management of the intersection. So
have there been accidents at that intersection?
I have not researched the accident data there. I don't know if Mark might know offhand, but I have not looked at that yet.
Yeah, not frequently. My only concern would be somewhat what Peter was saying and Eric is statistics show that it be warranted, because as soon as you do put the four stop signs, we're going to start getting calls from residents complaining while people going through it if it's not necessary.
Go ahead, Mary Lou.
I'd like to comment on the sightline aspect on the corner of Thornton and Sparhawk. We see this around the city a lot. I had commented on Cass Street coming out to Middle recently, that branches that are hanging over either sidewalks or the road really impede sightlines. And I'm wondering if there's anything that the city can do. You talk about this as being a sightline issue. Does the city have any jurisdiction to trim back branches that are hanging over that are a safety issue?
Yes, if it's hanging in the right-of-way, then the city has the right to go in and trim what's in the public right-of-way. We won't go on private property, though, and do some. Sometimes the amount of trimming that's needed would just end up killing the vegetation. It would happen so severely.
Right. But I've seen the crews around doing a lot of trimming over the past couple of weeks, and I just think there are a lot of areas that are blocked. The intersections mm-hmm. are blocked by trees and branches. So
yeah, and it's a really good use for the C-Click Fix app is a great way to get attention to those problems, because you know, get a picture of it and send it right in. I know I see a lot of it myself driving around, and
yeah,
I don't stop right away, then I forget about it, or I got to keep a list or send it in.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
Hey, any other discussion? So what's the pleasure of the committee here?
I'd just like to add, as living down the street, I think it is a very appropriate spot for a four-way stop. I would be curious, Eric. My feeling is there is a lot of pedestrian activity on these streets as well. especially in the last 6 months with people being at home. So I think it's a very good candidate. We have Dennett Street one block away that should be the through street for people traversing the neighborhood. So I support the four-way stop. I'm neutral on whether it should be done immediately or handled in the same way that all of our four-stop requests are done. But I do think personally, being a resident right down the street, that it is a very good candidate for a four-way stop.
Yeah, I'll just weigh in. Councilor McEachran Daglin lives in that area, and he was the one who kind of brought this on, you know, and I think there's a lot of families, you know, that are walking children and different things in the area now, you know, especially with the COVID. So anyway, I'm not going to push either way. You know, maybe we should get a report back and make a decision in August, get some real hard data, you know, on this. But I'm in favor of the four-way stop either way, however this committee wants to go. So
I can put together a memo. I can document sight lines and the volumes and have something on the record for everyone to see.
Okay.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman.
Yep, go ahead, Harold.
You know, I'm just questioning, are we going to have a meeting in August? That's what I'm concerned
about. Yeah, I believe we are. I have it on my calendar for August 9th, so we will have a meeting.
Okay, that's good. Thank you, then. All right.
Mr. Chairman, if we are going to have a meeting in August, then I would make a motion that states that we're supportive of the application, but for precedent, that we would ask Eric to report back confirming the appropriateness of the location, including pedestrian volumes, if you could, Eric.
Mm-hmm.
And just emphasis here being on precedent, that we want to make sure it's done right, but that it does look like a good candidate.
Okay.
I'll second that.
Okay, so we have a second. Any more discussion?
Yeah, I mean, while we're at it, we should look at crash data and see if there is, if there has been actually a dangerous intersection.
Okay. Okay, roll call vote, Amy.
Yes. Okay. Public Works Director Peter Rice.
Yes.
Planning Director Juliet Walker.
Yes.
Fire Chief Todd Germain.
Yes.
Police Captain Mark Newport.
Yes.
Mary Lou McElwain.
Yes.
Steve Pesci.
Yes.
Jonathan Sandberg.
Yes.
Harold Whitehouse?
Yes.
And Chairman Whalen?
Yes. So just to clarify, the motion is to move to request a report back from staff on an all-way stop control at this intersection and look at crash data, I believe, is what Jonathan said. Mm-hmm. All right. So the next under new items, request for an all-way stop at the intersection of Jewel Court and Brewery Lane by the residents of the area.
Yes. And this intersection is down by Plaza 800. This is the new condos, the apartment building that went in on the old DPW site back in here. There is some sightline issues at this corner. We did recently cut this back, so that sightline has improved just recently. And I do have some traffic counts pre-COVID that showed this. There is quite a bit more traffic on Brewery Lane than there is on Jewel Court, but maybe now with the apartments opening up, it's balanced out. I should really get some more updated data there. And the other issue is that Brewery Lane is not a public roadway. It's part of Plaza 800 property. And so this corner here, this bump out on the sidewalk is private property. So I'd have to look at that as to what it would mean to put stop signs on that leg of the intersection.
Didn't know that.
Wow.
Chairman?
Harold, go ahead.
Yeah, one question. Jewel Court, is that an accepted street?
I believe it is.
It is? We plow it? We take care of it?
Yes, we do.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Yeah.
Hey, Chairman, well, I'm willing to make a motion, but I just had a question for Eric.
Yep.
Do you think that it makes sense to wait a little bit to evaluate the traffic distribution at this location until the Islington State Corridor construction project has maybe returned to some kind of normalcy? Because, and also I think the fact that the Brewery Lane apartments have just been built. I just wonder if we want to wait a little bit to make the decision on this so that you can have more more time to look at the traffic flows through here, because I think that there is a potential that this could be an unbalanced intersection, which we wouldn't want to put in a stop sign if that's the case.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess my question is, do you think you need more time than just a few weeks or a couple months?
Yeah, it would certainly be helpful for the traffic volumes to normalize after the construction project is done on Islington, see where people are going. A lot of people are just avoiding Islington and taking the back roads in and out of Plaza 800 right now.
Right.
But, you know, the counts that I had back in February showed the still a heavier flow on Brewery Street than Jewel Court, but the apartments weren't open at that time.
Right.
So it would be good to give it a little more time and take a look at the data some more. I mean, we were proposing to make this a four-way stop on a temporary basis if when we were doing the Islington Street work in front of the White Heron, but that part of the project got cut out, so we're not having a detour in this area anymore. So it is something we've thought about, but we definitely would like to see the volumes out there to make it a permanent rather than a temporary measure.
Yeah. Also, there's already a new four-way stop at, is it Albany? And is it, I mean,
yes, Albany. Albany.
Yeah, I feel like it's already too disruptive. I mean, it's not a fun place to, I don't know, well, that should be fun, but it's a difficult place already. You know, you have to stop. There would be three stop signs there in consecutive blocks, pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing to be aware of, Mr. Chair, we're going to be putting a sidewalk along Jewel Court. On the Cleary Cleaner side of the roadway. So that'll improve the site distance by eliminating some of that hedgerow. So that'll make that intersection a little bit better visibility.
Hey, Erica, you had your hand up?
Yeah, I mean, my instinct is that Brewery Lane really is the, you know, that is an imbalanced intersection, certainly how it operates now. It doesn't feel like a four-way stop would be a good fit for there, as opposed to some of the more recent requests we've had where they're really kind of pretty balanced neighborhood streets. But I do think, Erica's good about getting us the data and looking at it and evaluating it objectively. And I think that's what we should do. And I think Juliet's point about it being an area in a bit of transition right now with the construction. And, you know, it certainly seems like a lot of those apartments or condos that I'm not sure which they are well occupied, but, you know, giving it all time to settle in before doing updated counts with the apartments occupied, I think is important, but doing it when we're not, you know, confounded by construction makes a ton of sense.
Yeah, I would agree with you. I mean, those apartments, Juliet, is that the only way in and out, that one lane? It is. There's no back road.
Well, no, you can get in through Chevrolet.
Can you get in through Chevrolet too?
Yeah.
I mean, my opinion is I think we just got to wait and see how this is all going to shake out a little bit. But I kind of agree with Jonathan, you know, that Brewery Lane there, I mean, there's multiple stops that we have a new stop sign down near Albany Street. You know, you don't want to have so many of them in a row, you know what I mean? But anyway. Mary Lou?
Yeah, I just wanted to comment on the sight line again. Peter, did you say that the bushes at Cleary's are going to be cut back at Brewery?
We're putting a new sidewalk. Eric, you can point to it if you could.
Yeah, along this side here.
Yes.
Yeah, because you cannot see around that corner. You have to come out. If you're coming down Jewel to Brewery, you have to pull out onto Brewery to see around those thick bushes.
Yes.
So that's another sightline problem that can be fixed, you know, faster than sidewalks put in.
Yes, and we did make some trimming to this just within the last week, so it has improved significantly, but it is still a concern. We can maybe possibly cut that back some more as well.
Yeah, thank you.
That's where the main thrust of this request came from, because it was so hard to see coming out of here. That's why I wanted it to be a four-way stop.
Yes. Right, great. Thank you.
Erica?
Yeah, I mean, I think just going along with the idea of a sidewalk along Jewel, I'd also like to see how the pedestrian volumes evolve. I think those, the apartment buildings really are potentially highly walkable, bikeable locations for people to live. So, I think we do want to kind of get that sidewalk in, let the construction project end, see how the both vehicular volumes and the pedestrian volumes settle in. It may be a situation where always stop is justified just because of the pedestrian crossing activity there, but certainly as it was 6 months ago, I wouldn't think it would be a good candidate, but it would be good to see 3 or 6 months from now.
Okay, so what's the board's pleasure? Do we want to table this or?
Mr. Chair, I'm willing to make a motion if 6 months seems acceptable, just to have the report back from staff be 6 months from now. Is that okay. doable or feasible?
I think that's fine.
A second.
Okay, so the motion is move to report back in 6 months from staff on an always stop control at the intersection, if that's acceptable to everyone.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, roll call vote.
Yes, Public Works Director Peter Rice.
Yes.
Planning Director Juliet Walker.
Yes.
Fire Chief Todd Germain.
Yes.
Police Captain Martin Newport.
Yes.
Mary Lou McElwain.
Yes.
Pesci.
Yes.
Sandberg.
Yes.
Harold Whitehouse.
Yes.
And Chairman Whalen.
Yes.
Unanimous.
Okay, so the next one on the agenda is request for pedestrian flags at Riverbrook Condos on Middle Road.
Mm. Yes, this, this crosswalk, we've had requests in the past from residents of the condominiums, and we've done studies of the volumes on Middle Road and speeds and the number of pedestrians crossing, and the problems at this location is vehicles do tend to exceed the speed limit of 30 miles an hour, and because of the limited number of crossings here, we've never had, you know, 20 pedestrians in any hour. It's one of those locations where drivers don't yield very often to the pedestrians in the crosswalk. Although we have found from the traffic counts, even during peak hours, there are plenty of gaps in traffic to cross. It's just that the pedestrian needs to wait longer to get a gap in traffic. Oftentimes the vehicles don't yield, and it's very frustrating and to try to cross at this location. You know, they've asked for pedestrian flashing lights, and you know, those are very expensive, and you know, the only people they would benefit would be the residents of those condominiums. It's not that large of a development. So one suggestion we had previously, and the resident I spoke with was receptive to the idea, was trying those pedestrian flags where the people coming out of the condominiums could grab a flag on the signpost and wave it and walk across and then deposit it on a container on the other signpost on the other side of the street. So I thought, you know, that's something we could try. It's a fairly low cost treatment to try and see if that would have any benefit. We also received a letter. I don't, Mr. Chairman, did you see the letter from a butter on the other side of the street? And she had several suggestions on other ways to address the speeding issue out there. And but, you know, she was suggesting more enforcement, more signage, you know, long-term, really, a sidewalk along that north side of the street would be a great way to keep pedestrians from having to cross, because then when they get closer to town, they have to cross again to get onto the sidewalk on the bridge going over the bypass. But
right.
It's one of these things where you really need some physical changes to the roadway in order to impact people's speeds. You know, you can post numbers on signs, but, you know, it's a nice wide road with wide shoulders, straight, and it lends itself to higher speeds. It's something where you really need a serious physical change to the road to have it.
It's a nice sound.
Okay.
Question on that?
Go ahead, Mary Lou.
Mr. Chair, just wondering if there must be a condo association. I was just wondering about the city using the condo association to inform people of how this is going to work for them, that it's to their benefit to use these flags and to use them efficiently and not walk home with them. So just using the condo association for information, education.
Yeah, have we had any discussion with the people in the condos at all, or?
Just, you know, from time to time, we've had these requests come in from one resident or another of these condos. So right. We haven't had any official representation as a, like a homeowners association.
Right. Steve, go ahead.
I think this is a perfect place for us to try these flags as a demonstration. It's cheap.
You install them. It's so intuitive that it doesn't need much more than a sign and a little, maybe a courtesy letter to the condo association telling them the what and the why and encouraging them to use it. And let's see how it works. It might be a very efficient way to deal with similar around the city. Durham, I think I brought this up with Durham has done it in front of the town hall on 108. I've seen it numerous other places and most of the flags don't get stolen. Just don't buy really beautiful quality ones. You
know? As long as you don't have anybody waving them in the middle of the road trying to stop traffic, you know, but no.
Might work. No.
Right.
We should try. So
what's the pleasure of the board here? Any
Mr.
other
Chairman, may I ask a question, please?
Sure, Harold.
Mr. Chairman, this communication, I just received it about 10 or 15 minutes before I sat down to this meeting. I don't have a computer. Now, this is dated July 6th. Is it possible to receive something like this in my mail or earlier than a meeting? I know I'm out of the ordinary by not having an email. So, but I don't appreciate the 11th hour type communication such as this, trying to read it and siphon it. But I really appreciate Ms. Hewitt writing this letter to us anyway.
Yeah, I mean, I think the gist of her letter, if I remember, was more about the speed on Middle Road and, you know, people coming
in. She mentioned flags, though. She mentioned the flags.
Yeah. I think she's willing to try anything.
Mr. Chair, we do have a capital improvement plan project for Middle Road proposed for longer term corridor changes.
Okay. So does anyone want to make a motion on this?
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion to approve the use of pedestrian flags at Riverbrook Condos crosswalk on Middle Road.
Okay. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Okay, second by Mary Lou. Any more discussion?
I mean, I just want to say this is okay, but I mean, ultimately what we want to do is slows the cars down on that road. I'll approve this, but it's just not satisfactory. I mean,
yeah, I'm kind of with you, Jonathan. I mean, you know, having commuted to Boston and areas, you know, when you get off 95 and you come zipping down 33 there, you know, it's kind of a speedy, that's the way into town kind of, you know, especially if you're in the South End. So, you know, I think, you know, long term, I think we've got to look at something to change the driving habits there. Mm-hmm. So,
Mr. Chairman, even though I made the motion, I'll be voting against it.
Okay. All right. So do we had a second, I believe?
Yes.
Okay. So
one piece of discussion, if I may. We had talked over the past year about this concept of the gateway points where there might be some unique sign that says, welcome to Portsmouth. This is a residential neighborhood, maybe the dynamic speed sign, et cetera. So I think to me, this is another one of those perfect transition spots to the chairman's point. You're leaving the highways, you're entering a neighborhood, welcome to Portsmouth. So I'd encourage the city to continue that concept of the gateway template with some kind of a treatment that becomes consistent. Mm-hmm. But for now, I support this motion.
Okay. Go ahead, Erica.
You know, I guess a quick comment too. I fully agree, I guess, on both, or, you know, kind of both efforts here. I think those flags are surprisingly, amazingly effective. I've used them trying to cross really busy, high traffic, fast speeding roads through neighborhoods before, and they've worked quite well. You kind of walk away, you know, some sort of like wooden, just a dowel with something stapled to it that's low cost, I think is a good way to go in case you do have to replace them. But I do agree with Jonathan, and as others have said, that, you know, it's not a replacement for the infrastructure that really should be in this location. I think it worked, the idea of it being the transition from in town to kind of longer distance travel works in both directions. And so you want to kind of send that message as people are coming into town that this is, you know, you're in town now, please treat it like you're in town now. But people often also apply that as they're leaving town, right? Like they're just like, oh, I'm done with having to drive slow. I want to kind of get on my way. So I think some signs and messaging in that regard, but I think also just the visual character of that stretch of road, you know, as some of the projects that have been described go into place, I think that those will help a lot in terms of speeds in both directions.
Okay. Mr. Chair, I'm very supportive of seeing infrastructure change out there, but I need to temper people's enthusiasm. We don't have the resources at this time to initiate those types of projects, and we will identify them in capital plans, but we have a lot of very important demands out there, and the council has the hard job of prioritizing those things. So I just want to make sure everybody's aware. We can do basic stuff, putting flags on dowels. I'm a little dubious that it will work, but you know, I've been known to be wrong. So I'd like to see the results. I'll support the motion just for that reason. That's my thought.
All right. Okay, any other discussion? Okay, roll call vote, Amy.
Okay, Public Works Director Peter Rice.
Yes.
Planning Director Juliet Walker.
Yes.
Fire Chief Todd Germain.
Yes.
Police Captain Mark Newport.
Yes.
Thanks, Mark. Mary Lou McElwain.
Yes.
Steve Pesci. Steve.
Caught me. Yes.
Jonathan Sandberg.
Yes.
Harold Whitehouse.
No.
And Chairman Whalen.
Yes.
Passed 8-1.
Okay, we move on to old items. Request to improve safety at intersection of Boss Avenue and Sunset Road due to limited sight lines by Sarah.
I have a verbal report back on this that we've checked it out. The sight lines are blocked by grading and vegetation on the corner, but it's all on private property where we're really limited to what we can do. If we cut back the vegetation, we'd likely have a lot of erosion on the grade bank there. So it's not a problem that can be solved by any physical changes out there. What I could do, recommend it would be to put a, you know, a warning sign on Boss Avenue, you know, intersection ahead, you know, one of those sideways T yellow diamond sign, yellow background. So just so that they're aware that there is a street coming in, but you know, it is probably mostly local traffic. I don't think it's a lot of cut through traffic here. So I think everyone's probably aware of it already. It's just that children, you know, kids like to come down the hill on Sunset Road on their bikes and skateboards and can't see what's coming. So it's important for traffic on Boss to know that this could be happening. Or we could put a pedestrian warning sign or something like that. Not playing, but a pedestrian sign. So that's my report back. We can put warning signs out there. I don't think we can have the committee endorse that, or it's not an ordinance, so it's just a warning sign that could go out there to warn people.
Okay. Thanks, Eric. Any?
Mr. Chairman. Are we voting on an issue, Mr. Chairman, in reference to that Boss Avenue and Sunset?
I'll accept the motion if you want to make a motion, Harold.
I move to support the request from the staff in reference to this.
I kind of lost it. Okay. Okay.
Are you ready for roll call?
We're ready for a roll call vote.
Okay. Public Works Director Peter Rice.
I abstain.
Okay. Planning Director Juliet Walker.
Yes.
Fire Chief Todd Germain.
Yes.
Police Captain Mark Newport.
Yes.
Mary Lou McElwain.
Yes.
Steve Pesci.
Yes.
Jonathan Sandberg.
Yes.
Harold Whitehouse.
Yes.
And Chairman Whalen.
Yes.
Mr. Chairman, before we leave old business, can I bring something up?
Sure.
Yeah. Can the staff give me an update on the blinking light that's being proposed at Gannett and Maple Avenue?
That was the next thing under old items, Harold. So it's a request for a flashing beacon at intersection of Woodbury. You're right. You're beating me to the punch here. That's the problem. Yeah. You're beating me to the punch, Harold. So it's request for flashing beacon at intersection of Woodbury Ave and Dead End Street by Harold Whitehouse. So go ahead, Harold.
I didn't see that.
Right.
No, I just want an update. We discussed this quite a bit, and it really touched me because of the young boy who was killed on that road. I just want to know, how do we stand in reference to that issue?
I can address that. I'm still looking at the situation, Harold, just to put a report back together for the committee yet. I should have something at our next meeting in August.
All right. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Go ahead, Steve.
It's just a very an adjacent issue at that spot, Eric. With the new bridge that was completed, it's really noticeable to me the shift or the mismatch in the lane. If you are getting off Route 1 bypass north, coming up the ramp to make a right turn or a left turn onto Woodbury, the traffic that's coming at you over the new bridge, that lane is shifted a good 6-8 feet, and it's very hard to see. So when you look at this intersection with your analysis, if you could also look at that ramp junction that's 100 feet away as part of it, I'm seeing a lot of risky behavior of people pulling way out of the ramp and trying to race a car that's coming down across the bridge. And I'm just curious how that lane shift happened, and if there is a striping match that we could do that might be all a little safer, and maybe it feeds into the junction that Harold's brought up as well.
Okay. I know what you're familiar with. They did widen it a little bit when they rebuilt the bridge. And the city, actually, we have a design to that on either side of the bridge that would have tied into that and made the alignment a little bit better, but we don't have the funding at this time for that project. You know, what we were able to do was remove the median island that was out there in the middle of Woodbury to improve the sight lines for drivers going into the school. The rest of the project has been put on the shelf for now.
I have mixed feelings about that, but I think it's, long term, I really wish the hotel didn't have two driveways either, but that's a whole other kettle of fish. But
I could take a look at that and see if there's something we can do in the short term to address that issue.
Okay. Does someone want to make a motion here?
I think Harold already did, didn't he?
Okay.
Am I confused? Sorry.
Yeah, I think you did, Harold. So it's the motion's moved to request report back from staff on the flashing beacon of Woodbury Avenue and Dennis Street.
Yes.
Look at the lane shift as Steve talked about.
Yeah.
So,
and that's an open action item, right? So do we need to vote again?
We need a vote.
It's an old item.
Right. So we don't need to vote again.
Right. So I'm going down here. Anything under miscellaneous that anyone wants to bring up?
Yes. Mr. Chairman, just one thing. Could I please?
Go ahead, Harold.
What was the main reason for moving from the top floor with the committee recommendation to have entertainment and wine and using of the top floor of the Foundry Broad? What was the reason for just calling that off and going down to the Bridge Street lot? Was there any idea what the reason was?
I can speak to that if you would.
Go ahead, Peter.
So the garage was not designed for occupancy of that type of activity. So the codes associated with the space really would be you would be in violation of those codes. And there are ways to get around them. Having the fire chief can attest, you'd have a what's called a fire watch. When you'd have a fireman there the whole time, the egresses and access weren't really designed for it. There wasn't appropriate bathroom facilities. The electrical facilities weren't designed to be able to handle that type of activity. So due to all those issues associated with really complying with the code, the question was asked, you know, after going through the exercise and realizing you'd have to invest a lot of money in trying to make that work, was there an alternative that would better suit the proposed activity? And the Lake Street lot was fulfilled a similar need and could easily be accommodate all the code concerns. So it was really a combination of you know, reviewing with the professionals and reviewing with, you know, fire and health, and the venue itself is, it's a beautiful view, but if you've ever been up there, it's very windy a good portion of the time. So a combination of all those things, it really drove us towards an alternative location.
Well, it should be made public because a lot of the public is asking the reason why, and never was publicized why the committee had to pull their ideas away and go to the Bridge Street lot. So that's all.
I believe all the decisions are online. They're recorded, and the meetings are all recorded, and they're all online. So it was discussed in public and in a public meeting.
I find it, Mr. Chairman, may I? Just one more thing.
Go ahead, Errol.
I find it very unusual, because I dug back in my minutes of December 5th, 2019.
Yeah.
We talked about the Foundry Garage and Harold Whitehouse. In the minutes, it says, Harold Whitehouse suggested they consider leasing the top level as a private for private function. I mean, that was 6 months ago. We could have had everything all settled by then. I should have been more boisterous, I think, in my request.
I think we all settled at that at the time.
The codes have changed since then.
I kind of agree with Peter. I just think there was a lot of logistics issues. I mean, you had to put generators up there. You had safety concerns with people being on a rooftop. I mean, there was just a lot of things, and I think the Bridge Street lot probably lends itself better, maybe, and people can use the garage, the park, you know, and use that as a venue. But I think the cost of doing it was also a big piece of it too, Harold. I mean, to make it safe and usable and everything else, there was a lot of hidden or upfront and hidden costs that for a month or two, it would be hard to recoup it, I think. But
thank you.
Mary Lou.
I have just a couple of minor miscellaneous. I'm referring to Saturday's event at Pease. I'm wondering if the city is, this is under parking and traffic safety, designating Grafton Drive as no parking on either side.
I don't know, Mark, Captain Newport.
Yes, I can mention that it's going to be no parking. It's going to be posted. Okay. I think that request has been made to DPW. Great. to parking.
Great. And then I have another issue. I saw in the police news a couple of weeks ago that a store owner complained about a moped. I think it was leaning on her storefront. So I would like to, and I'm seeing a lot of mopeds downtown parked everywhere. Next meeting, can we bring up the moped ordinances again and see if we can add on to or revise, because I think the store owners have a right to complain and ask for removal of mopeds, but it's not in the ordinances that they can't park in front of a store or leaning up against a glass in front of a store. I'd like to bring that up next meeting.
Yeah, maybe we can make that an action item, Mary Lou. I mean, I received a phone call, I won't say from who, from a downtown business owner, very concerned about it, and you know, the way the ordinances are written, you know, the police really couldn't do anything about it, you know, to remove
right, exactly, so
I think we should look at it as a committee. I mean, I think the moped ordinance was written probably 4 or 5 years ago, and we probably have hundreds of mopeds now versus what we had, you know, then. So
So I'm requesting that we bring it up as an action item for the office meeting, please.
Okay. Jonathan, I saw your hand up.
I just need to excuse myself. I have to go to another meeting. Yeah.
Okay.
I do as well. Thanks so much.
Okay. Is there anything else we want to talk about?
There were a few informational items.
Go ahead.
Okay, this is a graph of the traffic volumes. Like I mentioned earlier, we're back to about 80-85% of normal. This is the pre-COVID year, and then the depths of the pandemic, and now the traffic's been coming back up to normal. This is a summary memo of the ordinance of the all the items that this committee has acted on over the past year, and we'll be going to council for their readings, first three readings at the next council meeting.
Okay.
It's just informational item for the, there's nothing for the here for this committee to vote on. You've already voted on it over the course of the past year. And this is the omnibus packet here, along with the actual changes and the graphic showing the areas that the changes were made to. This is one item that's just a housekeeping item. It's taking a 3-hour parking area out of the ordinances because it's now a park next to the Memorial Bridge.
Right.
There isn't any parking there. And the rest of them are just the graphics that have been decided by this committee. And that's it. Oh, and then the accident report from Captain Newport.
Okay. Anything you want to mention, Captain Newport, in the accident report or anything going on?
We just I mean, it's, if you look at that, the numbers are down, obviously, because of the COVID situation.
They're not recorded.
Are you still on? Can you hear me?
Okay. Yep.
There was 350 total accidents dating back from June 30th to January 1st. Of that, there were 35 that involved personal injury accidents. And of those, there was 5 accidents that involved pedestrians and 0 accidents that involved bicyclists. And of those 5 that involved pedestrians, only 1 that caused a pretty significant injury to the, a leg injury to the person that got hit. The rest of them were like slow speeds. Either a pedestrian walked into the car that was going through the crosswalk, or they got bumped by a car because they were looking the opposite direction.
Right.
Mr. Chair.
Yep, go ahead.
Well, on that report, there's an asterisk there that says report forthcoming. So we don't have a current report, right, Mark?
So I know Amy put that in there, but there were the asterisks. There were no accidents. We had 0. I ran it. So.
Oh, I see.
I'm sorry, Captain Newport. That was me. So I'll correct it for the next time.
Yeah. So.
Okay. So there was nothing there from April to June. Okay.
And then there was no bicycle accidents any from January through June either.
Good. Great. Thank you. We're updating that.
Great. Okay. Any other topics? Go ahead, Steve.
I just want to again thank the staff for all the great work on getting the parking thing all cleaned up and trying something new. I think that's wonderful. And I want to express support. We started the deal with mopeds a year or so back, and we set it aside, and it's time. That's coming from a moped owner and rider. We have to bring those under control. We have such limited pedestrian space right now that we're trying to find ways to expand. And unfortunately, scooter riders are just, they're not being cognizant of the environment around them. And I am very concerned about pedestrian space and safety. And I think it's going to be a long conversation, but we have to figure out a way to regulate, manage, deal with them more appropriately. And then the other thing, I hope as we get into the fall, we can get back to, I know Eric started this idea of the graphic overview of speed limits and finding the mismatches there. I know you've been working on parking, but I just want to put those two things back on the long-term agenda list. They really need to be done. But to me, the moped's out of control. I'm very disappointed in my fellow moped operators.
Mr. Chair, I would add, I think when we talk about mopeds, we might also want to be thinking about electric scooters and other
e-bikes,
mobility devices that are going to, not e-bikes, Eric. just looking at how we want to maybe, I think the moped parking on the sidewalk is a very clear issue, but also if we get electric scooters, we're going to probably have similar issues.
Yeah. Right. I've seen more and more electric scooters downtown. I mean, guys on them. The one-wheeled ones, I mean, are unbelievable. But no, I just think we got to get ahead of some of this stuff.
Yeah, it's going to be a complicated conversation.
Yeah, and to Steve's point, you know, with the restaurants expanding on the sidewalks and into the streets, I mean, the parking areas are just going to become more limited. So,
you know, now is the time to try to carve out some street space for the mopeds, at least seasonally, and get them there. Now is the time to do this.
Right. Okay, so that's going to be on the agenda, I guess, for August. We'll stick it on there and have a frank discussion about it to get it going anyway. Anything else to come in front of the parking, traffic, and safety?
Mr. Chairman, I move the agenda.
Okay, is there a second?
I'll second that.
Okay, so roll call vote, Amy.
Public Works Director Peter Rice.
Yes.
Thank you. Planning Director Juliet Walker.
Yes.
Fire Chief Todd Germain.
Yes.
Police Captain Mark Newport.
Yes.
Mary Lou McElwain.
Yes.
Steve Pesci.
Yes.
Harold Whitehouse.
Yes.
And Chairman Whalen.
Yes. So thank you, everyone, and we'll see you August 9th, I guess. So,
yeah.
All right.
Stay well.